Hello and a very warm welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Pereira. India would stall cooperation with its foreign partners for development of civil nuclear programs if it is unable to become a member of the nuclear suppliers group. India has threatened to put on the back burner an MOU with Russia for developing 6 reactor units at Kudankulam. India feels that Russia must work more proactively for its NSG bid. Signs of India's resistance was made known when it gave no assurance to Russia's Deputy Prime Minister Dmitry Rogozin when the issue relating to the MOU was taken up. Rogozin took up the issue with Prime Minister Narendra Modi during his meeting last week. However, Modi offered no assurance on the issue, thus signalling India's disappointment about Russia not playing a proactive role on the NSG bid. India has signalled that without an NSG membership in the next 2 years, it would be forced to go for an indigenous nuclear energy programme. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will refocus on India's NSG bid and analyse if Russia can help India secure NSG membership. Joining me on the programme today are Rajiv Nayan, Senior Research Associate, Institute for Defence Studies and Analysis, Pallava Bagla, Science Correspondent, NDTV, Sheel Kant Sharma, former Ambassador, IAEA, and Kamal Mitra Chenoy, Professor, School of International Studies, JNU. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Ambassador, I'd like to begin with you. Can Russia do anything as far as India's bid to the NSG is concerned?
As far as NSG membership is concerned, no single country can pull it off. However, Russia has been supportive of India's role, India's position as regards NSG for a very long time. You know, I remember the days when we were not even through the Indo-US nuclear deal and we needed uranium. And Russians used to supply us uranium. And when NSG used to object, Russia would say, well, we have reasons to supply, and they would give answers and always support India. So that's it, Russia, and same President Putin. So Russia has been a long-time supporter of India. Then Indo-Russian nuclear cooperation has also been long-standing. So given this kind of a background and given this kind of a very close cooperation, if India expects Russia to play a role to push its case in the nuclear suppliers group, it is only natural. The problem is that the nuclear suppliers group, there's only one country, essentially, which is causing problems, which is throwing spanners in the wings. And that country is China. Now, since Russia is increasingly close to China, and since in the international affairs, China and Russia have been taking common positions, if we expect Russia to persuade China to see India's case, this is also natural.
The question really being, Rajiv Nayan, can Russia arm twist China into doing what, into doing this?
No, I will not say arm twisting, but as Ambassador Sheel Kant Sharma has very rightly pointed out, Russia and China have got very different kind of relationship, especially in the post-Cold War world. Before that, we know there was something called Green Line in Russian American export control system, by which the threshold level of American export control system was raised for, lowered for China. But afterwards, and we talked about US, China, Pakistan axis. But since then, things have changed. In East, whether it is in East Asia, whether it is in West Asia, in Middle East, whatever you call it, or other parts of the world, Russia and China are working together. And the most important issue is that the nature of nuclear supplier group has changed. Earlier, the COCOM, which was the first multilateral export control regime, was basically United States or Western dominated system. The new NSG, which came after in 1975 precisely, started getting members from different political groupings. Third World, China has become new member in 2004, and Russia was an original member to there. It is joined, and it's East Asian, East European countries joined also. So Russia has got better hold now. It can persuade some of the countries, and especially China. And it is playing, Russia and China are playing different kind of politics. I will not say against, but somehow to balance United States. So yes, it is quite valid that it is Russia which has got the real influence on China in the changed, you can say, global order, political order, nuclear order, whatever you like to call. So I think it has got leverage and it has got very good rap. That is the most important thing.
Pallava, Bagla, you know, as far as the MOU between India and Russia are concerned, India, of course, has been non-committal as far as MOU is concerned. So is it going to have any kind of bearing, you know, in the talks that Putin and Modi are going to have sometime in the near future?
Well, in my mind, there is clarity that if India needs large light water reactors, then India is left with the option of importing from Russia. The American option is more or less closed, with Westinghouse filing for bankruptcy in America. The French option with Areva is almost closed because the French company went down. So it's essentially large reactors, if they have to come, they'll come probably from Russia. Now, this is essentially posturing between India, Russia and China, where India is trying to pressure Russia to try and coax China to get a membership of the nuclear suppliers group. But at the same time, today, if you recall, the cabinet has cleared the making of 10 more large indigenous reactors. So if 7,000 megawatts of indigenous reactors have to come up, then Indian technology, make in India and made in India, is what will take the space forward. If imports can't happen, India will not lack for energy. India has its own reactors and they will go ahead with that.
Okay, fair enough. You're looking at indigenously developing the energy sector is what you're suggesting, and that's the way forward really as far as this sector is concerned. But Professor Chenoy, can Russia really, you know, persuade China? Because China has been very clear about India's NSG bid is concerned right from the beginning. You know, so any kind of external pressure do you believe is really going to work?
Well, first of all, China doesn't really have a case in terms of strategic policy or the capability of Indian scientists or the need for energy. China's had a problem with India for quite some time. And we know on a number of occasions, including in the Security Council and all of that, that China has not supported India. Now, in the relationship between Russia and China, China is increasingly becoming economically the greater power. So I think Russia has done its best. The only caveat I'd make to what Mr. Bagla said was that developing and refining nuclear energy technology is not easy. And we should not make haste on that. We should keep putting pressure on Russia, but we should also keep in mind that there are limits to Russian power as far as China is concerned, given the fact that you have a resurgent attack on Russia in the United States and in Europe, and there is the entire question of Ukraine. So Russia's leverage with China, I don't think is substantive enough for us to get what we want from them, even though they're sympathetic to us.
Sure. You know, there's much talk, Ambassador, about, you know, an indigenous program. India, many media reports are suggesting that India can develop something internally as far as nuclear energy is concerned. How far are we really from doing everything here, right here in India?
Well, let me at the outset say that there is a contradiction in what you're saying now and what you began. If India can develop indigenously, then why bother about NSG? Hmm. If you're so keen to get NSG that you're going to, as you said, put pressure on Russia, that means there must be something necessary to for you to enter an NSG. But in the same breath, then you say that you can develop indigenously. So one should be clear what you want. I think I take the clue from the professor, what he said, that technology in nuclear field is evolving. It has many dimensions. Even if Westinghouse might be going down, even if Areva might be going down, the nuclear suppliers group has still many companies in the West, including Westinghouse, which have relationships with each other, where technology is important. They have a fourth generation nuclear reactors, for instance, on which they have been working for last several years. What is happening is that economics of nuclear power has gone down in the past 10 years, and it is far more expensive. Hence, Areva has had a problem about supplying a reactor to Finland. It is still not clear. It was supposed to be given in 2010, but even 2018, 2019 is not very, very clear. French Electricité de France is now entering into arrangement to salvage Areva and to shore it up. Same way in the US, Westinghouse is developing linkages so that its basic things can continue. Japan, of course, has been a case because of the very terrible accident in 2011 and the subsequent impact on Japanese nuclear program. So Toshiba has had a different problem. But all told, if you want to be in the nuclear field for the coming half century, it is better to be interconnected with the world and be partaking of research and be a full partner. This has been the whole premise of the Indo-US nuclear deal, as the 18 July 2005 statement said, that they wanted, that the US wanted India to be fully involved with the global nuclear community as an advanced nuclear power. So that is the, we still want that. We still, and NSG is a step through that process. China has a totally it's a non-sequitur, because due to Pakistan, it wants to prevent India, which is nowhere in the NSG rules. Nothing there is there in the NSG which actually allows you to connect one country's membership to another country's membership. This is old Chinese hat in the Security Council. Again, India cannot become a member because Coffee Club objects. So, this is blunt real politic which China is playing. And from 2009 onwards, after the financial crisis in the US and the Western economies, China has become more assertive. So today, what you see is a threat to China. I would say, I don't care. They're very imperial. This tone of China yesterday, their spokesman says, India define what is meaningful. It's like a king telling, okay, you say this, so define this. They have to learn. They say on the one hand that India is a big power, we should play like big powers. And on the other hand, they want to talk to us down. So this is Chinese attitude. How to deal with that attitude? India has to find ways. So when India looks for friends, for instance, Russia has been a long-standing friendship, regardless of its problems with USA, regardless of its problems with everywhere. Let me complete. Yes. Russia has been fully supportive of India. So if you look to Russia for support, it's logical, natural, and if we do so, it is good. I have not seen any official statement so far about this Times of India story. Other papers have not carried it, that India is trying to leverage it. And this sometimes I don't know the facts because I have not seen anything. But sometimes we have a tendency, particularly in the media, to see more than what is there. So we should be cautious, because in diplomacy, you don't put leverage when you don't need to.
Sure. Dr. Rajiv Nayan wants to make a point. Yeah, go ahead.
No, I agree with Ambassador Sharma that our relationship with Russia, and especially in the nuclear field, has been quite time-tested, like the relationship in general. Plus, it's quite nuanced. India will never do this kind of very dirty, coercive, ugly kind of bargaining, that if you do not get us the membership of NSG and you do not put pressure on China, we are going to cancel six reactor order in Mirpur in West Bengal. So I don't think I don't think Indian diplomacy is that crude, and it is quite refined and sophisticated, and it's vis-a-vis Russia. So point is, who will do it? So India has to work with Russia to somehow, whatever you call it, pressure or persuasion, it has to use Russia. No one else can really persuade China to agree to India's membership in NSG. There are many other countries also. There are Western countries, huge block of Western countries.
What will Russia's leverage be?
Russia has got, I told it the last segment, that one is political. China and Russia have been acting, not only in West Asia, Middle East with Iran, but also in East Asia. And both of them had jointly developed a very ambitious, grand strategy to operate in Asia. And this covers the entire Pacific Asia also. So this is one. Economically also, though both are trying, I will not say they have become completely interdependent, but Russia is a lucrative place for Chinese, whatever you say, industry or whatever you like to say. It is a good market. Plus, both are working together. You know, Russia has got great human resources, a great strategic sense. Sure. China is coming up economically, but in certain technologies, it is still has to go a long way. And both have learned to work together for joint gains. They know that if they can work together, they can, I will not say overwhelm United States and Western Bloc. They are too powerful. Still, they are too powerful. But at least they can decrease their influence in the world.
Sure.
And India, Russia has to project India as a good, viable partner in Asia. And that they have to, I'm not saying they're arm twisting, you can disagree completely. But they can work with China and they can say that if you keep a standing between India and the membership, so India will also start behaving differently. Somehow we have to manage, we have, so far as I told you, we tried our best to manage Western, huge Western bloc. You cannot antagonize United States and the Western bloc and try to get the membership. Without United States support, you cannot enter into any international organization and you cannot get any international law amended. That's a fact. But as Ambassador pointed out, Ambassador Silkan Sarma pointed out, NSG, there is a veto power of each and every country. True. So you have to manage that country. And Russia looks a good friend, time-tested friend. And Putin is a different person. He knows to play the game. He knows, he understands world politics. He knows different dimensions of world politics. He understands China. He understands India. He understands what can be done in Asia.
Sure.
How India and China can be brought together. This kind of the relationship, this aspect, I think Indian diplomacy may have been trying instead of just arm twisting saying that we are going to cancel six
reactors. It's Indian diplomacy at work and it's going to come on top eventually is what you're suggesting and saying.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
and
yes,
we hope so. We hope so and we hope that really happens. Pallava Bagla, are we going to see a new thrust, you know, a new bid from India to make an entry into the NSG?
Well, an entry into NSG is required for several reasons. If India's own indigenous program has to grow in the fashion which India really wants it, then you need to import uranium. And import of uranium can happen reliably only when India becomes a member of the nuclear suppliers group. So you need to import large light water reactors. You need a membership of the NSG. To import uranium reliably over a long term, you need a membership of the nuclear suppliers group. And then India also wants to export its smaller reactors.
Mr. Bagla, hold your thought there. Hold your thought there. The other panelists are not agreeing with what you're saying. I'm going to come back to you and let you complete your point, but let a quick rebuttal here. Yes, Ambassador.
No, I'd like to just enter a caveat here. It is not correct to say that in order to import uranium, India has to be a member of the NSG.
Australia has agreed to give it to us.
We have bilateral agreement with Canada, Australia, Kazakhstan, everyone.
And France.
And so there's no problem.
Yes,
I think this is wrong.
Yes,
2008 exemption is enough for getting uranium from inside.
Look, number one, as Ambassador Sharma had pointed out, we have a problem with China because China has a problem against us because of Pakistan. And Russia has severe problem because the kind of Russian baiting in the United States and Europe now is unprecedented since the McCarthyite period. So to think that Russia can forcibly cause a change in NSG is not true. But as Ambassador Sharma has just said, that there are various ways of our getting uranium, etc., for our indigenous reactors. But the problem is to increase our capacity and to improve the quality of our reactors, which means they'll become more efficient, we do need some technology. And that is where the NSG becomes important, but not overall the only option. And therefore, I don't think we should talk too much about what Russia should do or could do in a situation where Russia is already doing its best. And we must remember that in 1971, when Russia supported us on our Eastern Front, it had to support us because the United States sent its aircraft carrier there. So it's not that the United States also does not have a leaning towards Pakistan as compared to India. So I think given all this, we should move cautiously. The press should be extremely cautious of what it writes and says. And I do think that if we play our cards carefully, we will succeed in moving ahead. But that is going to take time and a lot of diplomacy, because there are internal contradictions in the suppliers group. There are also internal contradictions amongst the great powers. So it is not going to be easy. And we should try and give as many concessions as we can without harming our ultimate goal.
Sure.
Because this is a tough talk.
Sure. You know, one more thing, Professor. By being non-committal on this MOU with Russia, are we jeopardizing the relationship somewhere?
Look, the Russians know us also very well. If we actually were non-committal, they'd know very well the reason why. They know we're not anti-Russian in any ways. So I don't think this thing of either Russia being too weak or Russia being non-committal or India being non-committal on Russia is fair to either side. I don't see diplomacy ever having worked that way between India and Russia for a long time.
Sure. Yes.
Now, on uranium, I would like to say 2008 exemptions in NSG ensured that we would get uranium. And in fact, we received uranium from Russia, even low-enriched uranium for Kudan Coulomb reactor we have already received. Second, we have received uranium from France. We have received uranium ore and we have further processed it. We have received uranium from Kazakhstan, from Uzbekistan. Now we have got agreement with Australia, Canada, somehow Namibia, the agreement with Namibia did not materialize because of other reasons, commercial agreement, but agreement was there. Plus we had agreement with Mongolia. So there are many countries which are really ready to supply. So this uranium is not the issue. The real issue and the real issue for the membership is that you are sitting on the high table and where rules are formulated. Like it or not, when United Nations Security Council Resolution 1540 internationalized export controls, nuclear suppliers group and other multilateral export control regimes were taken as reference points. Because all the developed suppliers sat there, they formulated rules, they developed list. Because and they in fact defined dual use technology by preparing a list. So in that way it is relevant. When in 2008 exemption was given, immediately after there were restrictions on ENR technologies. So and that necessitates that we should sit there. There are many other advantages. If you have got time problems.
And so unfortunately, I have time constraints of the program, so let's not get into it. But let me go back to Pallava Bagla and ask him to complete the point he is making. And also, what's the way forward, really?
Well, the way forward is to persuade all the countries to unanimously take India into the nuclear suppliers group. And in that, winning China is critical. Now, to win China, last time America applied a lot of pressure on China, it didn't work. So India is using a different tactic to ask Russia to support its membership into the nuclear suppliers group. How much soever I disagree with Ambassador Sharma, who is a great authority on nuclear issues. It's the issue is about reliable supply over a long time. So uranium reliably to be supplied over a very long time, India really has to be a member of the nuclear suppliers group. You can't expect to run a 50,000 megawatt indigenous program without a reliable supply of uranium. For that, India has to be sitting on the high table.
Okay, sure, fair enough. Okay, I'm going to get quick closing comments from all my guests on the way forward, really, starting with you, Ambassador. I'm out of time on the program, so very quickly, your closing comments on the program.
I think we should keep working with Russia. I think we should not jump the gun, saying apply pressure or arm twist. About China, we have to be careful. So the more China is inimical to us, the more we need friends everywhere else in the world. So I think in that respect, in diplomacy, we should not try and go with a key like John Quixote, with you know, fighting against windmills.
Sure, sure. That's a very valid point that you're making.
Yes, there are two issues. First is about NSG membership. Of course, we have to talk to China also. That is basic. Second, we must use Russia's relationship with India and with China. And Russia, and ask Russia to persuade. I do not agree with the viewpoint that we should leave Russia aside. If United States can talk to its allies and friends, why can't Russia talk to, even if it is not called, China is not called ally in pure sense of term or technically, but it's a very good friend and they are working together and they are working together very closely. So they should do. Second part is nuclear reactors. So we have got multidimensionality in our relationship. One is now we have signed an agreement to explore uranium. Since Pallava Bagla is raising this issue again and again, so let me tell him that both of them have got an agreement to explore and mine uranium in other countries also.
Right.
So this is another dimension of it, plus constructing uranium in third countries. So there are many other dimensions if you see the original agreement. I have got the agreement. So India and Russia, I don't think going to ditch each other. They have got very deep-rooted, better understanding, and in tougher times, when there were sanctions, Russia stood up for India. When Tarapur had problem, then Russia really supplied fuel to India.
So the ties are deep-rooted. So
very deep-rooted. Yeah.
So there's no problem really between the bilateral relations
and
between India and Russia.
India knows how to talk to Russia, and Russia understands.
No, I Professor, close the show for us with concluding remarks.
I think we should also see if we can tweak our foreign policy a bit and get into some kinds of terms with China, whether it's the South China Seas problem or other problems. The real problem they have with us basically is the Dalai Lama in Tibet.
Yes.
Others are consequential. So we should also see if we can engage China. Because there's no point writing off China as an enemy. We know its worldview. We know the difficulties we've had. But as the ambassador said, we have to increase our circle of friends, because Russia cannot do this on its own for us.
Sure, fair enough. On that note, I'll have to call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Rajiv Nayan, Pallava Bagla, Sheel Kant Sharma and Kamal Mitra Chenoy. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's all the time we have today. See you again next time.